So, exoplanets. It's crazy. When I was born, people didn't even know that exoplanets existed. And now, 25 years later, there are thousands of them. And so we're finding all these exoplanets, and there are categories, entire categories of planets that we didn't even know existed, that don't exist in our own solar system. Mm-hmm. Like super-Earths.
Super-Earths, those are really odd.
Yeah.
What would that be like? So you're on a planet that we're pretty sure is solid, has some kind of a solid surface, mm-hmm. but these things have like 4 to 5 times the mass of the Earth.
Right, so a huge gravity.
Yeah. Right, and the question of if super-Earths can be habitable. One question would be, can plate tectonics exist on super-Earths? And I've mm-hmm. heard conflicting mm-hmm. theories of if it would be more or less likely. And plate tectonics is probably something that's kind of necessary for life, right?
Well, it certainly has helped life on Earth. That's for sure.
Life as we know it, anyway.
People really take that for granted. You know, plate tectonics has allowed the Earth's climate to be both, you know, relatively stable, but also to change. You know, not so stable that nothing changes. Mm-hmm. You know, several times we sort of sucked all the carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, and then the planet's gotten very cold. And what warms it up again are the volcanoes. You know, it kind of keeps our whole carbon cycle in balance. And people have no idea how important plate tectonics are.
So this ring of fire around the plate boundaries is what keeps things going.
So what's next for studying exoplanets? I know you're working with WFIRST. How would WFIRST contribute to our knowledge of exoplanets?
It should make a major step forward, because what we'll be able to do with the coronagraph on WFIRST, so this is an instrument that blocks out the star, and they can block out the starlight to a factor of 1 part in a billion. And then you can actually see the exoplanets around the star.
Right, so the direct imaging.
Right.
Which would be
We
awesome.
Won't be able to see the oceans on them. It's not that kind of imaging, but we'll be able to see that it's a spot and look with a spectrograph and see, is there oxygen there? Mm-hmm. What's the atmosphere like?
Yeah, that would be amazing to be able to actually do spectroscopy and see the biomarkers on the exoplanets. What would be the ideal thing you'd be looking for if you're trying to find Earth's twin? What would you be seeing?
That's a good question spectroscopically. I mean, one of the big things people talk about a lot is oxygen, because mm-hmm. Oxygen is very difficult to keep at any high level of abundance in an atmosphere, because it combines with everything. So it's one of these things where something has to sort of be actively putting it into the atmosphere.
Yeah. So I guess there's like basically 3 different ways that we're searching for life. We're looking for life within our solar system, most likely microbial life. We're looking for biomarkers on exoplanets. Mm-hmm. And then also looking for trying to detect extraterrestrial life.
SETI, that's right.
SETI. Right. Which of the 3 do you think might give us results first?
Oh, I think we'll find microbial life in the solar system before we have confirmation of it elsewhere. I mean, I think for a while we're going to have exoplanets that we think, oh, that looks really interesting. You know, I mean, people will argue whether that's enough methane or enough oxygen to really show that you have life. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I mean, I think we very well may find microbial life in the solar system in several places. Mm-hmm. It may be on Mars and Europa and Titan and Enceladus. I mean, there's not just one place we might find it.
We'll probably see signatures of oxygen on exoplanets, perhaps before we find microbial life in the solar system.
True.
But we won't know how to interpret it exactly.
So that's just a bet, you know, and I'm good friends with Seth Shostak.
I am
SETI,
too, yeah.
And Seth always teases us at NASA, because he says, well, you guys are looking for pond scum. I'm looking for civilizations. Yeah, right. I'd be really happy with some pond scum.
And he made that prediction earlier this year saying that we're probably going to find extraterrestrial life by 2040.
I hope so.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah.
Now, on the other hand, if we found a signal with SETI, you know, I think it would alter the entire, our whole civilization.
Yeah.
You know, I definitely think that there's life out there, because in our own galaxy, we estimate there to be about 100 billion planets. That's based on the Kepler statistics.
Amazing.
One galaxy, right? And we know.
So there's as many planets as there are stars.
Just about.
Just
That's
about.
Right. I mean, something on the order. It will be a very different world. I mean, I will wake up in a different universe. Even if they detect a signal with SETI, even if it's not a communication thing, even if we never decode it,
right.
But we get something that we can say, this is definitely artificially done. You know, whatever the signal was, it's mathematically coherent, it has to be artificial. You know, then the next night you look up in the sky and you know somebody else is up there thinking. You know, somebody else has a technology, has a civilization. That's a whole new universe.
Yeah.
We detected a periodic signal. We thought it was periodic in the gamma ray band from a nearby star. Hmm. It turns out to be spurious. But there was about 3 days where there were a couple of us that were saying, gamma ray communication.
Wow.
Well, it's a great time to be alive. I'm excited for
the
discoveries that are going to be happening in the next few decades.
And think about the change you've seen in your relatively short life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, let's hope there's at least that much, and maybe more in the time to come.
Well, thank you very much for talking with me today.
Thank you. That was fun.